Hey, good afternoon, everyone. I am hoping that everyone who is listed in the participants is able to hear the meeting. I don't see everyone in the windows like normal. But I'd like to start the meeting of the Mayor's Blue Ribbon Committee on Arts and Nonprofits. It's Monday, July 26, 12 noon, and we're in Conference Room A at City Hall. We are a majority in-person meeting, and we do have a quorum today. So I don't think we need to do a roll call at this point. So the first thing I'm going to look for is a motion to approve the minutes of our June 28th meeting, which were circulated earlier this month by Kathy.
So
Larry made the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Courtney seconded. Any discussion, changes, anything on the minutes? All right. Is all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, excellent. Moving on, we've got a pretty full agenda today, and I do want to see if we can get through this in 1 hour. So we're going to start right off the top. Nancy Carmer from the city staff is going to do a quick overview on ArtSpeak, just to get everyone in the loop on the background and history of ArtSpeak, and then we'll move on from there. So Nancy, you're on.
Thank you, Wes. Thank you, everybody. I had an opportunity to speak with Barbara last month and talk about the history of ArtSpeak. I think in reading the minutes and watching the recording in the last minute, the last meeting, there was some question about what is the status and how did it evolve and how did it devolve? And many people here in the room, Russ and Robin, were members of ArtSpeak. In fact, maybe both of you were chairs at
yes,
some point.
Yeah.
So this timeline spans a history from 1999 to about 2018, 2019. And it started out with then Mayor Sorrell's Blue Ribbon Committee on Arts and Culture. So be careful. And their charge was to develop a cultural plan for the city, which this group did in earnest. They held a series of public hearings, focus groups. It was really quite comprehensive. It was an 18-month effort. And what evolved out of it was a culture plan. I have copies here I can share with people. If you don't absolutely need it, please return it, because we have just not that many copies left. But so it was really quite an undertaking and an impressive document. And actually, the city of Portsmouth was the first city in the state to have the plan adopted into its master plan. So that was these were exciting times. And there's the plan is simple but also complicated. There's six simple goals, but lots of objectives, goals and objectives under each goal. And the last goal was to develop a cultural commission, which Mayor Sorrell, with the help of then City Councilor Joanne Grasso, developed an application process for a 13-member cultural commission. And it was a pretty in-depth cultural commission application and effort. And out of it came a really robust group of folks in the arts and cultural community back then. This was, I think, 2001. From that point on, the city had an annual agreement with the Cultural Commission, which went by doing business as ArtSpeak. They incorporated as their own 501c3 because it during the discussions about how to develop and should it be a city commission or should it be a separate 501c3. Lots of discussion about not wanting to compete with our cultural institutions, fundraising, that type of thing. So the city kicked things off with some funding for ArtSpeak. I think it was about $25,000. And they also helped pay for the incorporation for ArtSpeak. And then throughout the years, there was the job was really implementing the cultural plan and some. So I'll just go over a few highlights, and you'll probably remember some of these things if you've lived in the city during this time. But in 2003, one of the goals is affordable space. Isn't it interesting that we're still talking about affordable space for not only arts and culture organizations, but for artists? And they took this on with vigor and held a couple of forums. They brought this national company called ArtSpace in to do a public forum. We had great representation from the real estate community and businesses, and great participation, and some goals for the community. And I think when you think about affordable space for organizations, what really transpired during this time was PMAC didn't exist.
That's right.
The Loft didn't exist. 3S didn't exist. So a lot of seeds were sown, and a lot of things came out of the work that ArtSpace did. Not so sure we did so great on the affordable living for our artists and our band members and our visual artists, but at least we had some really good entities that still exist today for our cultural community. ArtSpeak also launched an opt-in directory. So when you wanted to share a stage, you could go online and say, hey, I need a stage. Hey, I need some lights. And so there was this collaboration back then, before there was the social media that we have today. ArtSpeak did hire its first part-time coordinator in 2004. Then they launched the overnight art. I don't know if people remember the temporary overnight art initiative. There were two of them over the course of ArtSpeak's tenure. Each year they were required to hold some type of symposium under contract with the city. And over the years, there were several on developing public art, on trying to think what some of the other ones are.
There was the business side of art for artists.
Oh, totally. There was a whole series of seminars for artists on marketing, on taxes. It was quite
contracts.
Contracts. It was insurance. It's really robust. And then ArtSpeak jumped into the AFTA study, which the initial AFTA study was done out of the Economic Development Office with all volunteers, and then ArtSpeak picked it up, and I think did the subsequent three or four studies. It was in 5-year intervals. And that was an enormous help for the city, because it helped us quantify what we know today as the economic value of our cultural community here. And the thing about the AFTA study is it's just for nonprofits. It's not for profit. So this number that we have, I think we're up to $58 million annually at the last one in 2016, didn't even include our for-profit galleries, our historic homes, some of those things that are for profit. So, some good work there too. And another big thing that ArtSpeak did over the years that really helped the city is we didn't have any guidelines in place for when people wanted to donate art to the city. So developed art acquisition guidelines, deaccession guidelines, helped with this, with preparing the percent for art that we have for city construction projects, helped oversee the process for implementing the Foundry Street Garage percent for art, also middle school percent for art, which I think is still a viable thing, but it got put on hold when the budget for the middle school exceeded what they anticipated. Let's look at it. If you look at the cultural plan, there's a lot of goals on engaging youth with art. And we were fortunate to have some art teachers on ArtSpeak board over the years. And the Youth Art Month was a huge thing. The youth working with the, is it called Heat?
Splash,
and then Leap for the Community.
Oh, Leap was the other one, yeah.
Leap for the Community. And these were working in the middle school with our young children in the art classes. And then we had a reception for them at the library, and those were great events. So over time, I think you'll see that we had a lot of success. In around 2018, 2019, there was a lot of change in the board and in leadership in ArtSpeak, and they came to the city and they were really at a crossroads. And this was right about the time that the city, the year before, the city had instituted with the help of then Councillor Nancy Pearson, this policy for reinvestment in the arts. And that was using a percentage, you know, based on the AFTA study of patrons that come to art events in the city, spending money on parking. There was an allocation of roughly 1% of the city's parking revenues. It was for a period from 2017 to 2020, but it had to get allocated and appropriated every year through the budget process. It was allocated and appropriated for the first year, and it was $100,000, of which I believe $48,300 were expended. And the whole idea of this was to have a sustainable funding source going forward, because I think it was hard for a quasi-public agency to always have to be fundraising for their existence and finding themselves a little bit in competition with our organizations that are cultural organizations that are fundraising at the same time. Anyway, the board was at a crossroads in 2018, and leadership, you know, came to the decision that it was best for ArtSpeak to dismantle. So we started the process with the city's legal department to do a mutual release of our responsibilities. So that was signed in August of 2018, I think. So that was the run of ArtSpeak, but I think part of the decision in doing that was looking back at the cultural plan and looking at the goals and looking what was implemented over time. And I think in some ways it was the end of a chapter, and another way it's we're at a new point now. Much has happened. It's probably time for a new cultural plan or a new engagement of 20 years of new people in the city. And so that's where we are.
Thank you.
A long
awesome.
History.
Thank you.
Great.
So Nancy, when this was dissolved, so to speak, did you also end up dissolving the 501c3?
So that was not our responsibility to do. ArtSpeak was they were actually used the balance of the funds that they had, not the reinvestment of the art funds. Just we had funded them at about $15,000 a year. If they used those funds to do some of that legal work for dissolving the 501c3. I'm not sure if it's even complete yet, but
I believe it is dissolved. I did like a state search.
Oh, you did? What was you saying?
I believe it is dissolved.
And the website, as Barbara's pointed out, the website.
Casino
is,
in Nevada.
Somebody else has it. Yeah.
There is an ArtSpeak casino that has taken over the website.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Well, it has taken over the name.
That's right. So you mentioned monies allocated and.
So, yes, there was. Are you talking reinvestment in the arts?
Yes.
Yeah, to clarify, there was $48,300 spent. There were metrics on how that had to be expended. And then the balance was 50, was the math, 51.7.
51.7, yeah.
On that. So that still exists. It's still appropriated. And it is on the books.
I just wanted to add two other things that I recall that they did do. One was they brought a lot of the creative marketing folks together and created a marketing campaign called A Tiny Bit Huge. It was like kind of like we're Portsmouth and yeah, we're a tiny bit huge. There was a logo. They tried to push it out, but it kind of never really went anywhere. But there was a lot of effort put into it. So you might still see things around like decals of things that say a tiny bit huge. And the other thing they did was they created a program and website where artists could, where people who owned their own buildings but wanted mural or art or something.
Street canvas,
right.
Yeah.
They could post those projects and artists could go online and propose ideas. And the amount of money that was being paid was there, and there were some matchups of artists and build and
that is what
and
so that 483 went to, and I think Port Walk, you'll recall there was a street canvas installation on Port Walk. They went to private entities, and there was an installation on, I think, a fence, a dumpster fence, and there was a couple other and then there was a blog. There was an ArtSpeak blog that was very active, and then they did spotlights on artists. They did video spotlights of local artists.
And then last, thank you. I was just going
to mention that,
which was done by an intern, and it was a map of public art and art in public, which are two different things. But it was a map of both of those things.
I really think the takeaway from ArtSpeak and the success of it was not only marketing the city toward the latter part, but putting us in really good stead by quantifying the value of our cultural community here, and also putting the city in terms of policy. We now have best practices for guidelines for public art, for accepting art, for deaccessioning art. And then our percent for art ordinance. So I think those are some of the ones that really stand out, in addition to the other laundry list of good things.
Thank you for that, Nancy. Any other questions or comments?
I have some questions about the figures. 483 was
spent,
and so there is 51.7 left. Is that correct?
So I've been in just preliminary conversations about that remaining funding now that has been approved for arts use in the community. And my perspective is that this group has been called together to work with the city to find opportunities where the city can support arts recovery and efforts to reinvigorate the arts economy as we come out of the pandemic. So while I'm certainly not in the position to access or commit any of that money, I think that there are discussions to be had with the city manager and about the accessibility of that funding for this group for some of the projects that we're working on, particularly the marketing efforts that we've talked about, whether that can be used to jumpstart an effort to market that Portsmouth arts and cultural organizations are reopened for business. And I think that that would be a really effective use of those funds. So more to come on that in the near future. Our city manager is on a much needed vacation, a much well-deserved and earned vacation right now. So I haven't had a chance to speak with her about it, but I will be pursuing that. And Barbara and I will be working on that in between meetings to see what access we could potentially have to those funds for the projects that we're working on right now. Since the city has already allocated that, designated that specifically for arts use. So I'm very hopeful there. Without anything further, I think we should break from the order of the agenda because Ben Fletcher, he just stepped out of the room. Of course, he took a phone call. I want to get to Ben sooner rather than later. We can go on to the next thing quickly. Why don't we go on to the upcoming AFTA Arts and Economic Prosperity Study? And Nancy was just going to give a quick update on that as well. And then Ben's back in the room.
Sure, and I'll make this quick. It's time again to do the next AFTA study. Actually, this would have been the year to do it, but mercifully, the American for the Arts decided to postpone it until 2022. And they've reached out to the city. I know Robin's had some conversations. I've had some conversations with Ben Davidson, and he has sent us a contract. And I've spoken with the city manager about perhaps contracting again to continue this trend that we've had of doing this arts and economic prosperity study over time, and just hopefully we'll see that things have come back after the pandemic. It will be really interesting to see what we find in terms of the surveys from 2016 to 2022. I think I misspoke when I talked to you last week, Russ. I said that the surveys weren't going to be done until the second half of 2022. They're actually going to start in January. It's the surveys of
the
audience surveys begin, and I have a schedule here that I can share in January. And then the organizational ones, which I understand is an improvement to what's happened in the past, more streamlined, easier, not quite as cumbersome, will begin in the last quarter of the year. So, and again, trying to give these organizations, you know, an additional year of operations for reporting on their revenues and their performance. So the cost to participate in it, the basic cost is $6,000. And I spoke to the city manager about it and willing to, you know, because it is part of the economic department, and we use these funds a lot to market. I mean, we use this study a lot to market the city to businesses that want to locate here. I have funding in my contingency line item that we could use to do this study. Now, there's ancillary things you can do to bring Randy Cohen, the executive director here, to roll out the plan once the data is out. That's something that can be talked about later. Maybe it's appropriate for some ARPA funding or something. It's not a lot of money. It's like $2,000, those types of things. So that being said, the city is, you know, willing to help fund the effort. It's just we want to make sure we have the capacity to do these surveys. It's not really heavy lifting, and it's kind of fun to do these audience intercept surveys, but it requires. You know, a lot of planning, a lot of organization. So I think talking to Russ, there's some ideas of how we might be able to do it with our cultural institutions in a more streamlined way, maybe have some volunteers from each of the organizations help do this. And then, of course, needing to circle back once the other piece of the survey, which is surveying the arts organizations to see what their revenues are like over the year and what they spend on employment and vendors and that type of thing. That's the other half of the equation. So
Nancy, does this also include like the historic house museums, or so it's pretty broadly stretched out?
It can't just be performing venues, it's historic homes, it's dance groups, it's
even the Seacoast Science Center.
Seacoast Science
is considered a museum.
Yep, museums. as many individual artists as we can. It's
I don't think surveys could come.
Can
I jump in?
Yeah, go ahead, Robin. You know that well.
I chaired or co-chaired the last two. And we had a very, very well-attended workshop. It might have been at Strawberry Bank, or it might have been the library, I can't remember. But there were representatives from most of the nonprofits, and we did a training on how to do audience intercept surveys. We have to do a minimum of 800, and there's a quarterly goal that we send them in quarterly. But I probably personally did a couple hundred, but the idea was that each organization knew about them, when it was appropriate to do them, how to download them, where to bring them back. And we met our goal. We didn't exceed it really, but we certainly met our goal of 800. That's the minimum. It's great if you can do more. But
you have to do 50 surveys at 15 events over the course of the year. So you can divide it up.
Right. But our geographic area includes Rye. So I think there was Seacoast Science Center, and there might have been something other historic in Rye. I don't think it. I'm not sure. I don't remember if it includes Kittery, but I think that it does.
I think we went up to Southern New York.
So, but yeah, it was. We met our goals, which was important, but only with the help of every single arts organization. 800 is a lot of
service,
actually.
So, you know, what Nancy and I were talking about was the idea of, since we have a critical mass of organizations on this committee, that it would be an opportunity to really leverage each organization to be responsible for their own surveys. I think ArtSpeak took on a lot of the work in prior surveys and came in, and organizations did step up and do their own surveys as well. But I think that if we divided it up into the organizations, a strategic way to do it, that each organization should be able to implement a certain number of surveys on their own and reach our goal pretty easily without any one organization having to carry a significant amount of weight.
And is it just individuals that are surveyed?
For this particular survey, this is an audience survey. So I administered it as well. I remember often standing in the lobby of the music hall before an event and asking people to fill out forms and getting information. Basically, the information you're collecting is where are they from and how are their spending habits that day as a result of that event. You know, did they go out to a restaurant? Are they staying at a hotel? You know, how many people, how much do they spend on their tickets? How much are they spending on concessions? All those types of things. And then all of that data goes back.
They
ask about babysitters. For those of us with kids, we know what a significant expense that is for the lifetime of our children.
And what's good too is that if there's a party of four, say one person answers on behalf of the four. So it was always great when we could find a group and ask one person in the group to do it. But we certainly did it at Prescott Park, at the music hall, at the rep before dance shows. All organizations made announcements about what was happening so people would rally.
Yeah. No, I think it's the data is really important to our community. It really helps people understand the impact that the arts sector is having in our community. And I think it's going to be, you know, don't think that AFTA is waiting until things are better to collect the next set of data. They've done actually an excellent job of collecting data over the course of the pandemic. They're doing it different ways. It's less audience-based because there have been no audiences for the past year. And thank goodness we're finally getting back to audiences at this point. But they've collected a ton of data on how this pandemic has impacted the arts organizations and the working artists in our country. And so 2022 is going to be like the first chance to interact with audiences. And then the organization data will just continue on from what they've already been collecting during the pandemic. So they'll still see that curve of what's happening before the pandemic, what happened during the pandemic, and how long it takes to recover from the pandemic and then get back on track. So a lot of that's through the organizations. The audience surveys, I think, are going to be absolutely critical. And I'm really fascinated to see if they're going to have any unique questions that are related to coming out of the pandemic of their audience surveys this year.
I think that's a good idea. And also, there is an opportunity to survey in a different way for the first time our for-profit arts and culture industry, which is interesting to me.
So we're working on that. We have a deadline of September. So
yeah, I think
to file the application or to accept.
And I think they would be flexible. But I think what would be helpful to the city is how are we going to administer this? You know, who's the in charge? Is it, and who? What's the volunteer? You know, is there a committee that can help? Something similar to what you had done in the past, right? So. Maybe that's a discussion for another time.
Go ahead, Renee.
Yeah, just a question. You may have said this, I apologize if I missed it, but in terms of the audience surveys, are they all in-person surveys as opposed to there's no email surveys?
Correct. Yeah, they all have to be asked at the event while the people are there. So would it be, what would be the most helpful thing for this group to move it to the next phase? Would, what comes to mind for me is Barbara and I could work on putting together a document. You could reach out to all the organizations and say the following organizations are committed to participating in both implementing audience surveys for their organization and providing the organizational data when that's required. Would that be helpful?
Yes. Okay. That'd be very helpful. I mean, I think we can also think in terms of UNH interns. We can get help to actually do the surveys. Yeah, I think that those are the next steps.
Yes, I would think too, just brainstorming, I think you probably know it, the other costs involved, whether it's actual downloading paper or putting something up, but we also created, ArtSpeak created an and gave this to the organizations free was a brochure just like this that had the key indicators in it for Portsmouth so that they could use it and send it in to people who were doing grants or whatever. So that was an expense that was well worth it.
Yeah.
Besides bringing AFTA, we brought AFTA, Randy Cohen, the Vice President of Research from AFTA in and did a big chamber breakfast with him. So he did a presentation to businesses, was at the Sheraton, I think. Remember when we used to have those big morning breakfasts a long time ago? And then did at Strawberry Bank, he did a presentation for the agent, for the nonprofits, and some of it was on how to use the data to benefit your organization.
He's done them at 3S Art Space, and he's also spoken, of course, at Rotary Club.
Yep,
so
yes.
He really does get out into the community in a big way. Go ahead, Barbara.
Nancy, is there is it possible that we have access to the historical files from the previous iterations of this so that we can see like who actually participated the last go around or the last two go around? So when Russ and I start this potential outreach, we're starting with a foundation of who we know might really be interested.
So working backwards, we have all of the studies, and I brought a copy of the last one here. We can pass it around. You can see how in-depth it is. But I think you're asking about the organizational work in terms of who's the volunteers, what organizations did. And we can probably check the Art Speak files and see. And I don't know, Robert, did you have any of that from your committee?
Well, we have spreadsheets galore. I just don't know where they are.
I feel like the list is only about 40 organizations as far as audience surveys. It's not a huge work list. So I think it's recreatable. And there are probably organizations around now that didn't exist then and ones that are no longer around. So I think it should be pretty easy.
I think we can access, I know we can access the Art Speak class. It's just a matter of finding that.
Okay. So we're not trying to recreate the wheel. We have something to start with. And
what would be most helpful from those files is the organizations. We surveyed the organizations, and I think we were almost up to 60 organizations.
And you may want to totally fresh eyes on this, but I'm certainly willing to co-chair.
Write that down.
The group. I'm not here for a couple of months, but I'm reachable.
But we could go to Florida.
Yeah. Florida meetings are
so. I guess the other question is that, and I know Rick's here, is that this Blue Ribbon Committee life is the life of the current city council.
Right.
So is there a way to at least, we need to present Rick with a report of what we have done, and then maybe a recommendation that this be continued under the new city council when you're looking for an organization that might be the center for overseeing that all this is happening rather than completely starting from scratch. I don't know what people's thoughts are.
I think you're 100% right. I don't know the path to getting there and how detailed it's going to be, but I think that's probably a conversation best for Barbara and I to have with the city staff and the mayor over the next month. Maybe we can report back in August about how to see what happens after, because the change of our council will be in January.
And we do have our minutes from all of our meetings, so it's not a heavy lift to put together sort of a summary.
Oh no, that's not at all.
Of what happened with this particular Blue Ribbon Committee.
Totally. Yeah, well, I think the summary report happens no matter what. I think that's something that we want to do annually anyway.
Right.
And figuring out the path to what happens in 2022 is the real question for me. And I'm not an expert in figuring out how that works. So I think it would be Nancy and Barbara and I speaking with the city manager and the mayor, figuring out what the next steps would be to get there, and how that would happen. So that's something that I'll make that we should talk about in August. Okay. All right. So we're quickly going through all of our time, and we have a guest with us today. So I want to move the agenda around a little bit. Ben Fletcher is here from the parking department. And one of the topics that we spoke about in our meeting last month was the potential for public art. And one of the scenarios that we looked at, which has been very popular in this country in recent years, is public art that involves crosswalks within the community. And so being part of the park department, Ben has a breadth of knowledge that I do not have about rules and regulations and how these things work. So he's been invited here today to speak to us about what's possible and what's not possible with public art regarding safety and other issues with crosswalks. So I hope that's an adequate introduction.
Good afternoon. Thank you everyone for your time and inviting us to speak today. So the first thing is city staff is always excited about the use of artwork to draw attention and increase viability in downtown areas and things of that nature. So we do want to understand that crosswalks are designed to heighten awareness for drivers and pedestrians alike, so that they can, when they see them coming, they know that there could be a heightened number of transactions between pedestrians and vehicles in that area. And with that said, I did a little bit of research, and I have a study from the Federal Highway Association from 2011, where their official ruling, I'll just read just a segment of this, and sort of let me discuss. Their official ruling stated that the use of crosswalk art is actually contrary to the goal of increased safety and most likely could be a contributing factor to the false sense of security for motorists and pedestrians alike. And they went on to say that subdued aesthetic treatments between marked lines, such as pavers or brick lattice patterns, things of that nature, as long as they don't diminish the effectiveness of the legally required white traverse pavement markings, those are allowed. And so they went on to say that no element of aesthetic interior treatment is to be random or unsystematic, and no element of the aesthetic interior treatment can implement the grass symbols or multiple color arrangements. So that said, certainly the city is open. I've already spoken briefly with Nancy about this. The city's open to looking for alternative areas to do these types of things, but we are hesitant to support in a safety related issue like this. We're hesitant to support this in the crosswalks and the official markets.
So I have a question, which is, when we've been looking at this and looking at examples of crosswalk art elsewhere, what it really does is it's art that exists within the crosswalk linear patterns. It's not over that. It actually highlights the crosswalks. That they're referencing that there. So when we're talking about crosswalk art, we're really talking about adding some color and being respectful of what a crosswalk is supposed to do. We're curious as to, we've got several examples from other communities, is how have other communities been able to do this?
My understanding is that got at least one example here where a community has been delivered information from the highway and transportation, federal highway and transportation folks, that in a rather sternly worded request to return the crosswalks to their original. So I don't know how those will play out over time, but the government's response, the federal government's response, has been to immediately return those back to the original.
The report, I took a look at that report. I think the conclusion at the end of it was only two or three sentences. Do you have that on your paper there? It's like that two or the very last thing, it says conclusion, right? Can you just read those two or three sentences at the end?
Chapter 3G of 2019 NUTC contains provisions regarding use of colored pavements. A colored pavement is used to regulate or guide traffic or otherwise attempts to communicate the roadway user. The colored pavement constitutes a traffic control device. Agencies cannot intentionally exclude elements of retro reflectivity as part of a systematic process to classify The color payment is purely aesthetic treatment in order to circumvent the provisions of Chapter 3G. So it seems to support.
Oh, there wasn't something. I had read something about aesthetic exception at the end.
So there's another paragraph here. Paragraph 3, Section 3G01 and UTC limits the use of colored pavement as used as traffic control device to be colored yellow and white. Interim approval of 1A14 or IA14 permits the use of green colored pavement for bicycle lanes. All other colors for use on highway pavement in the right of way are either disallowed or are experimental as described above, unless the colored pavement is purely aesthetic treatment and makes no discernible attempt to communicate with a roadway user.
Yeah, so that last phrase is the one that confuses me. Like, if it's an aesthetic treatment that doesn't make an effort to communicate with the user.
And I can't speak for the federal highway folks. My take on it, to be honest, is simply that the crosswalk itself communicates with the driver and communicates with the user. And the use of standardized markings throughout the country is paramount to everybody's understanding of the use of the roadways. And I think it's just, in my personal opinion, professional opinion, is that I don't want to go down a road that might change the safety aspects of a crosswalk.
Okay, cool. No, I really appreciate you coming here to speak to this because it's important to the conversation that we've been having. When I read through it, it referred to not only the crosswalks, but any type of directional paint that's applied to roadways, and also referred to barriers that I read as being central barriers in between or medians on roads. I didn't see anything that referred to sidewalks or anything like that. Do you have any opinion on applying sidewalk art in any part of the community or anything like that?
And I'll let Nancy elaborate on this too. That was one of the things we discussed that we thought might be a neat idea. It's
yep.
just be a matter of trying to find a place to do it that's appropriate and then determining what was needed to have that done. And so then Nancy, if you'd like to elaborate on our short conversation on that.
It was a short conversation.
Andrew, elaborate.
But it was like, okay, we're getting the sense from the guidelines that it's probably not optimum. It's not allowed, I guess, to do this in crosswalks. So what are their alternatives? Where are some other places? Are sidewalks a place where we can boost vitality in certain parts of the city? We did speak a little bit about Vaughan Mall because that's a pedestrian. I know that the Blue Ribbon Committee on Vaughan Mall, which the mayor was on, and we talked about doing some 3D art when you come with, I'm sure you've been in cities where you come upon some 3D thing, and it's like someone coming out of the sidewalk.
Those are falling
into a canyon or something like that. But again, now Vaughan Mall may be disrupted because of the sewer project, the separation project in the future. So maybe it's an opportunity to do a temporary thing in Vaughan Mall. The mall is looking really good right now and really busy. I'm not sure it needs much more vitality. Maybe there's other places where we can do this on the sidewalk. So I think it's really
all of that asphalt all along the waterway. We're redoing Prescott Park, but for the time being, if somebody really wanted to do something like that, I don't think filling everything, because it does get slippery with some of these paints, these acrylics and stuff like that, but maybe doing something. It literally is the whole water end of the park. It's all black asphalt.
So for those who can't hear, the mayor is suggesting, that's okay, suggesting the possibility of waterfront areas, including Prescott Park, surfaces like that for potential artwork. I mean, there are lots of places throughout the community where there's potential for surface artwork that does not impact any type of traffic or anything like that.
Around schools too,
around
because
schools.
We talked about not just downtown, but
So when we had our meeting last week, Russ came up with the idea, and at that point we were still pursuing crosswalk art, but that if we were to be in concert with our mission, which, as you know, is to promote the arts, revitalize the entire community, and provide funds for individual artists, that we might want to link whatever art style we choose. Style is not the right word, but anyway, that we could link them so that we made sure that there was something going on at 3S, there was something going on at PMAC, there was something going on at Strawberry Bank, something under the Music Hall Arch, something at Seacoast Repertory Theater at 3S, the New Hampshire Art Association, so that we were tying it in to various arts organizations. And so maybe what we want to do is look and see if there's some way to create some form of art that's linked so that there's a reason for why you're doing it where you're doing it. And maybe we could also add to that schools. But it seemed that that made a lot of sense to the sort of little subcommittee that we met with. We recognized that there were a lot of complications to implementing whatever the project might be. We think to try to do anything the end of this summer and fall is really probably not very realistic, that we ought to continue to work out what it is we want to do, what are the parameters, how the artists would get chosen, where's the funding going to come from. So we need, you know, a lot more time. And we also thought, I mean, it would be interesting, but that we needed to really survey a lot of the other communities and find out what have they done to, you know, revitalize their communities through the use of the visual arts in particular. So that just gives you a sense, and we knew from your discussion, Kathy, with the city, that they were had grave concerns about going ahead with a crosswalk art component, but at the same time, they were willing to work with us or have us work with them as to what would be a good alternative.
No, I definitely agree with that. And, you know, earlier, Nancy and Robin were talking about Arts Week and overnight art. One of my favorite overnight art installations was Sidewalk Art by Barbara Reed and Jenny that happened in Goodwin Park, I believe, in the first iteration of overnight art. So there has been success in the community within the past. It was very well received. And I still believe that it's an opportunity for artists and the community to connect. And I love the idea of community members who are in the immediate area of impact for where the art would go, being involved in the process, helping through the process. And I also do firmly believe that this is also an opportunity to actually pay artists in our community to participate in this program and create the artwork, whatever it is. Go ahead, Jason.
I absolutely love the idea. It seems like a lot of the time we tend to gravitate the ideas towards our downtown, which I certainly understand. But very much in line with some of the conversations we've been having on the sidelines, it's about what are we doing that gets out to the neighborhoods around Portsmouth, very distinct neighborhoods, Panaway Manor, where my mom lives, Elwin Park, you know, places where, again, this goes to this feeling of, you know, hey, not my Portsmouth anymore. I grew up here, but I don't really go downtown anymore. How do we bring art out to those neighborhoods? And I jokingly have this phrase I use, Yortsmith, you know, it's your Portsmouth. It's, you know, the Portsmouth that you don't really feel connected to anymore. So to surprise and delight in neighborhoods, not just, you know, hey, come to town and see this. It's not, we're gonna come to you. And I know it's not, you know, it's difficult to scale, but I wanna challenge us to think about it through that lens, is how do we go out and show up in unexpected places where the people in that neighborhood go, ah, this is cool. Like, you know, this is my Portsmouth. I just wanted to throw that out there. Yep.
I think that's absolutely key.
Any other comments on this topic?
Yeah, I just want to, Jason, we actually, maybe it was at the last meeting where we talked about starting outside and working our way in, which may not happen, but we hit on those very things, which also is how do we involve our own city committee, the neighborhood association. You know, they're doing National Night Out in a couple weeks, and they're pretty active in their own groups, and we talked about how do we potentially connect with them so they have a hand in whatever's being done, if and when we do something like this, that we're not doing it to them, that we're doing it with them. And that's a way to pull in the neighborhoods and make them a part of the arts community.
Thank you, Barbara. Yeah, that's great. I do recall that. So thank you for kind of reemphasizing that. I think it's critically important.
I love that idea. And I think the neighborhood organizations are a great way to start what Jason's talking about, connecting with people who are passionately and actively involved in the neighborhoods.
And finding out what it is they want.
Exactly. What do they want?
Superimposing something on top of them.
Yeah.
But what is it that would be desirable in your community that you would like to see happen and that you could help make happen?
I agree. The one other thing I want to acknowledge in this meeting really quickly is that a fairly large group of community members came together over the past month since our last meeting and raised about $10,000 for public art that they want to designate to this committee to use for public art. There's some stipulations around it, but I think it's the effort I think was really really sweet and really very sincere that there is a desire for there to be some public art. The effort was around the idea of inclusion within the community, which is a main theme of Portsmouth. We want Portsmouth to be inclusive. So I just want to mention that I'm appreciative. Kathleen Cavallaro organized the fundraiser, and there's really, at this point, no way for this committee as a group to accept any funding. We don't accept funds. We don't have any accounts or anything like that. But I know that there were many, many residents who contributed to that particular fundraiser. So I just want to publicly let them know that we are very much aware of this and that we will be working in the coming months to figure out, you know, how to honor the efforts of the community and figure out the best possible way that we can participate in that vision. It initially had to do with a crosswalk, and as we heard today, crosswalk art is likely not an option for this community or communities anywhere in the state. So it's something where I don't have the area of expertise to challenge that, don't have necessarily the interest in challenging something like that. But I do think that the spirit of the money that was raised was to do something very publicly about inclusion within the community. So we're going to take a careful look at that and get back to that. But I just wanted to acknowledge that for the many, many people in the community who participated in that fundraiser. Go ahead.
I just wanted to add that another thing that came out of the Brooklyn Art Speak is the establishment of a public art trust.
Yes.
So I don't know what this group wanted, but it might it's possible they might want to have this put in the trust with the caveat of public art for inclusion.
Yeah,
or whatever.
It can be a restricted.
I'd like to have more information about that if that's an avenue they want to go.
Yeah, definitely. I will definitely speak with them and figure out, but it's something that's not going to be navigated overnight. But I did want to acknowledge that we're very honored to have had so many people within the community step forward in the name of creating public art. So I think that's good. Any other comments? Thank you, Ben. I really appreciate your time today.
Thank you, Ben.
Thanks for inviting.
We have one other thing that's on our agenda. We've got about 5 minutes left, which is probably not enough time, but Jason was going to speak to us on an update regarding the marketing work that we were talking about. Do you want to take a few minutes and give us a quick update?
Yeah, certainly. We met a couple weeks back. So it was myself, it was Monty from the music hall, it was Larry. Beth, you were on vacation, but I think we've kept you in the loop on emails, and then Ben and Michelle from the chamber. And Russ, I think you've already hit upon it, so I don't think we need to spend too much time, but I think that the question really that we have right now is accessibility to potentially that $51,000 remaining. And might we be able to, I think what we'd like to do is propose exploring a partnership with the chamber to develop on a pilot marketing plan. So kind of take a look at what we can do for whatever dollars that we do have access to, really start to try to develop out this tourism marketing plan and learn from it, set specific metrics that we can say, okay, you know, we're achieving what we're setting out to, and hopefully, you know, lead to a broader engagement with a larger budget, perhaps from the American Rescue Fund, something we can talk about later. But right now, I think what we want to do is just start putting pen to paper on this tourism marketing plan in collaboration with the chamber.
Excellent. Any comments or additions to what Jason just reported?
Just a question, Jason. Would the dollars be used to hire a marketing consultant to bring that together and choose a firm or something to do that? A consultant? Is that how some of the money would start being
spent? I think, you know, that's still to be determined, but part of what we proposed was doing an RFP and finding potential marketing partners. Yes. Go ahead, Beth.
Yes, hi, thanks. I'm just a little confused because I thank you, Jason, for this. I fully support using the funds that were already designated to help with these 2021 recovery efforts in the marketing piece. But as we talk about this public art piece and got clarification around the crosswalks not being possible, but other neighborhood activations, where's that pot of money coming from? Where are we projecting that public art pot of money coming from? And is there an opportunity here to, again, ask more from the city for the public art side so we're not splitting that 50K on public art and marketing? I'm just a little confused about where the budget for this other piece is coming from.
So we talked about this last week and recognize that the one thing, one of the priorities going forward with this, whatever shape it takes or form, is the funding component. We did not recognize we didn't have a funding component in place, but we've also heard the urgency and the need to pay artists if we're going to involve them in these projects. So it wasn't assumed that we didn't even know how much money was left in the ArtSpeak fund. We weren't thinking that we would be using that money. We just recognized that we would need to find an avenue to raise those monies.
Yeah, I don't think there was necessarily an intention to use the remaining arts funds that the city has necessarily for public art at this point. I'm thinking that the $51,000 that remain for arts designated use within the city at this point is likely not close to enough to do a meaningful marketing effort. So my hope is that some or all of that money can be used to seed an effort, pilot an effort, get something going that gives us enough data and enough of a structure that we can use that to potentially make an ask for ARPA funds or other types of funding. When we all signed on to participate in this process, really the ask from the city was, can a group of arts leaders get together and help the city better understand what the city can do to help the recovery of arts and culture within the city during the recovery from the pandemic, which is gonna take a few years. So we're looking at every possible option of what the city can do to assist in this. Jason, I absolutely love what Jason just said. He spoke about tourism. I also think that we need to be speaking marketing locally and regionally as well as beyond that, because our own community needs to understand better that arts and culture is back open for business, that it's safe to participate in arts and culture events, and why, and what we're doing to keep our audiences safe as we come out of this. And what's happening within the community, because we want local community participation in all of our organizations. This is not just about bringing tourism into the community, but we also do recognize that tourism dollars have a huge impact on our local economy, and we want the economy to recover for everyone within the community. So that's what we're thinking. So I don't know if there's a direct answer to your question, Beth, other than none of the money has been allocated yet. And I think marketing is still a top priority of this group as a result of the surveys that we did with organizations earlier this year. And that was a high priority. At the same time, figuring out how to provide opportunities to directly support artists within our community is also a high priority. And that's, I think, where some of the public art ideas come in. But we're gonna have some conversations with the city about accessing those funds and whether or not we can leverage those funds to pilot something that could be further funded beyond the initial pilot by additional funds at some point. Does that clarify at all?
Yeah, no, thank you to everyone. And I just, I'll leave this for another time, but Nancy, I so appreciated your piece around art speak, and I'd love to get back to that idea of that 1% for art. I understand it needed to be appropriated, allocated on a yearly basis, and then it stopped at 2020. But I think as a group, we'd be interested in knowing from a city's perspective, what's the appetite to renew something like that, renew a sustainable funding mechanism so that we can support arts recovery long-term and where there's potential there.
I agree with you 100%. I think that's a great opportunity.
I do think the other thing is, and we'll be in a better position to talk about this in a month, but we need also to be aware now of what is the impact of the Delta virus and what are we seeing happening in this particular area. So it might be helpful at the next meeting to get an update from our health people of the city.
Yep.
What are they seeing terms of the Delta virus, because it seems everybody's very concerned.
Yeah.
And yet at the same time, it seems that if you are vaccinated, that you're in a much better position than if you're not vaccinated. So we just need, I think, to understand, is that going to be a deterrent to visitors coming here or to people within the community, particularly being willing to go inside for art performances going forward.
Totally. There's a lot on the line this fall for arts organizations. Once the weather starts to cool off, we need to go back indoors. And this Delta variant is a major concern, so point well taken. We can talk about, Barbara and I can talk about having the health subcommittee of the reopening Blue Ribbon Committee possibly come, because I know they're still active. Okay. Any other comments or questions? We're just up against the clock here. All right, that covers our entire agenda. The only thing we didn't have here is public comment, and there are a few people on the phone. I see Laura turn on her camera real quick. Laura, did you have something?
I do. I am here to help this on behalf of Friends of Ruth Lay. I'm here to help the city spend some of that $51,000. We have a mural of Mary Carey Dondero that we would love to do. But seriously, so we are having our unveiling tonight at 6 o'clock of the Ruth Lay mural at 165 Court Street. All of you were invited, but Evite is telling me that some of you have not even opened your invitations. So just show up 6 o'clock tonight at 165 Court Street. We're going to have a very brief unveiling ceremony, and then we're hitting Liar's Bench for a reception afterwards. And if you need any information, it's friendsofruthblay@gmail.com. Hope to see you later.
Sure. Thank you, Laura. I'll see you tonight. Thank you so much.
Good night.
Any other public comment? You coming up? The mayor is here. Yeah, go right ahead.
Just real quick, again, I just want to thank all of you, and it's actually nice to see everybody. Just a couple of things, and based off of what your conversations are, I am 100% fully on board. I've talked to Russ about this before, and Barbara, as far as this is a committee that is going to be funding at some point. We have not asked any. Well, up until this point, as far as even discussing anything, I've even talked with Jason Goodrich as well, with a couple of things. It's going to take money, and we all know that. And I think the council would acknowledge that. I think we are open that if you are looking for funding, if that is brought forward to the council, even if it's just under my name or just on the agenda itself, it's an ask. That please, by all means, ask. Any of that, I've talked with a couple as well, as far as giving a breakdown of basically what the funding is for, you know, where it's going allocated. That's all that really needs to be done. I mean, I think that's anyone's question. You don't just throw money at something. I'm grateful that Nancy brought forward, and she had told me once back that there was money. I didn't really want to get into it, but then it was my place. So when the time was right and the question was asked, we would fulfill that. I have also started doing it, and we have a long way to go. But I have secured, at least with one bank, with a $25,000 donation that would actually go to this organization. I'm meeting next month with another bank. Anytime I have the opportunity to meet some of these large companies, corporations, banks, I'm hitting them up. Actually, the city manager is pretty impressed because they're not shy about it. I attended an event a week or so ago out of Keys with a very large corporation that's out there that I think would be beneficial. I basically told them that I didn't see them acknowledged a lot when I came to nonprofits.
they do some stuff in the community, and I kind of encourage them for next year, and I'm hoping to be able to get, again, this would be for next year. And then again, there's another local bank I'll be meeting with next month, and again, I'm not shy about it. Any of the nonprofit organizations that help all that literally, I'll raise quite a bit of money for scoreboards and other activities that will level up beyond the costs. And then as far as Arts and Cultural Committee, I don't want this a blue ribbon. I don't want it any more than it has to be. I don't want it, regardless of what the outcome is with elections and changing hands every 2 years. This is a committee that is important. And ArtSpeak stepped up and they did what they did, but what I don't want to do is I don't want that falling through the cracks again. Whether it be you people or whether it be your successors, this is a monster crew of every organization. Many that I grew up with and both my family, my company has kind of helped out, and we need to continue that. So I really want to go and start talking with Bob Sullivan about creating this before this council actually finishes this term, so that you guys have to know where to go. So, and as far as you guys talked about trying to get working with the neighborhood steering committee, I believe they're going to try to squeeze two more forums in. They have neighborhood forums in each one of the wards, and maybe somebody from this organization going to one of those meetings and including them.
Yep.
So that you guys can ask the questions. I think the surveys are great. I'm looking forward to a little bit of everything that you guys are doing. Again, I just want to in person thank you all for what you've done and hopefully what you will be doing in the city.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Anything else? All right. I think we're good. So if there's nothing else, being adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.
Something from...